a while, they'll have the middle camera, which is
everything. All right.
Okay. What's he saying?
We ready? Okay. Welcome to NJ Discover.
Welcome.
You are listening to NJ Discover TV. I'm going to do this little, like I always do, a little commercial. We're on the air, you know.
Yeah.
Everybody, we're on the air. To find out more, go to njdiscover.com or follow us on Facebook, the NJ Discover production page. And you can also follow us on Twitter. So we are on the air, and we have a really, really, really interesting show tonight. Mm-hmm. And as we always do, I want to introduce my wonderful co-host. Huh. 4 years we've been hanging out.
Yeah.
4 years together. Tara Jean Vitale.
Gosh.
You're now introduced.
Thank you very much. Okay. And I'm going to introduce my co-host, actually the head of the show. I would say you have to be considered the producer. You put so much work into the show. You work so hard to bring everybody here and everything together, and I thank you for that.
My pleasure.
It's always a great show, and you are Rutgers' biggest fan, and I got to say, he's like the ever-ready bunny because he never stops moving. He's constantly doing something, and my very dear friend, Calvin Schwartz.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And I appreciate that Rutgers thing because I'm going to do a monologue right now. This is now my official Johnny Carson, Jimmy Fallon monologue. First of all, I too want to give a shout out to Rutgers University because I always wear a Rutgers hat, and particularly all colleges in the particular area that we're in, you know, Princeton and Monmouth and Brookdale and Rider, because I have come to appreciate the joys of being close to a college campus, and I love a college campus, and I love the sports, and I love the lectures, and the environment, and the energy, and I happen to be particularly close to Rutgers, and having graduated from Rutgers back in the 60s. You remember that? No, you don't.
No, I
that.
Don't.
Remember. None of you
I
remember
wasn't
that.
Born.
No, so, but, well, yeah, I take that back. So, anyway, also to another shout out to Rutgers, they just hired a new football coach, and I do spend an inordinate amount of time running to football functions because it's a wonderful thing, and it helped my son and I get so very, very close because this is what we started doing 20 years ago. So a new shout out to Coach Chris Ash at Rutgers. Moving on, and this is almost an ad lib, but I've been getting a lot of fan mail lately, and the fan mail, a lot of people want to know about my hat and why I always wear a hat all the time. And I'm going to kind of let the
secret. And it's not because you don't have hair, because you've got a lot of hair.
That's right. It's actually because I'm going to be entering, and I've tried to keep it a secret. I'm going to be entering a senior citizen mullet contest on the boardwalk of Asbury Park in April. So, all right, I did it.
And, you did it.
And my wife
now
said,
they know.
My wife said, Calvin, don't say that on air. It's stupid. I said, no, I got to do what I got to do. So, moving along, I want to thank you, Tara Jean, and I want to thank Kurt for being with me last week at the Freehold Borough Arts Council. That was a great show of support, and I thank you very much for that. I was asked to address the annual meeting of the Freehold Borough Arts Council, and I thank you for that. Often on this show, I do a little segment. Things that scare the hell out of me. And I'm going to tie that in, because there's always things that scare the hell out of me, and I'm going to tie that in to what I did. You know, we do a kind of a show and tell here, because you guys don't know, but we do like a show and tell. What did you do last weekend? Stuff that, you know, when you're third grade, you know, teacher said, what did you do over the weekend? So we do that here, but we, you know, do it with a little bit of a twist.
Right.
So, anyway. What I did last weekend is I went to a rally to stop ocean drilling in Asbury Park, and it was great. It reminded me of being back in the 60s, and they had Senator Booker there, and who actually remembered me. I met him at Rutgers a couple of years ago, and we talked about I'm from Newark, and he's from Newark, and we talked about certain health pursuits that he does, and I do some similar things, and he kind of remembered them when I re-met him again. But things that scared the hell out of me, they're having a rally, and actually the president, we don't do politics here, but the present administration is actually considering doing ocean drilling off the coast of Virginia. And that, to me, scares the hell out of me, because if there's another slip-up like BP, then the whole East Coast, the entire East Coast, is affected by and wiped out. Mm-hmm. So that kind of scared me. Hopefully they can stop that in a couple of weeks. A couple of other things. I did go Friday night, and I have a shout-out to Mike Tomasino from Catch a Rising Star in Princeton. I hung out with him for a couple of hours. He had a wonderful comedy show Friday night in Princeton, mm-hmm. where he had the heiresses of comedy. And I got a chance to talk, because I'm an NJ Discover guy, I had a chance to talk to Mindy Rickles, that's Don Rickles' daughter, and Jill Bryan, that's actually Jimmy Kimmel's sister, and also to Sheba Mason, that's Jackie Mason's daughter.
Wow.
Talked to them for a whole bunch of, and you know, maybe NJ Discover can do some stuff with Catch a Rising Star.
I'm sure we can.
And Saturday night, I kind of hung out with Peter Yarrow for a little bit from Peter, Paul, Mary. I'm dating myself. That's my kind of music. I'm a 60s folky guy. I am what I am. Anyway, I want to thank our sponsors, The Windmill. We have a new sponsor tonight, Neo Zoe, mm-hmm. and Marianne Castello. She's a holistic doctor. And before we do an official commercial, and I just want to say how we met, and that was a very spiritual thing. I do a radio show with Danny Coleman on Sunday nights called Rock on Radio, and a couple of months ago she called in to ask a question, and she saw me, and we chatted on air. And then the following week, she called in and sent a message to my co-host Danny Coleman, "What's wrong with Calvin? He doesn't seem," she only saw me on the screen.
Mm-hmm.
"So something wrong with Calvin. I can feel it. I can sense it." And meanwhile, my knee was killing me, because you asked that before. Yeah. And just amazingly, she was able to feel and sense. And that so moved me that a few weeks later, I went up to see her. And a few weeks later, I spent 6 hours in her holistic Neo Zoe
wow.
health center.
That's a long time.
That's a long time. So
how'd you feel after all that?
I felt different, and I felt good. And it was a wonderful experience to do all those aromatherapy and different kinds of massages.
Ooh, that sounds really nice, actually.
And she evaluated all my nutritional things and the things I take, which is 2 pages of the things I take. So anyway, what did you do?
Me? Well, I saw you. We went to the Monmouth Museum in Lincroft, and we did that because we wanted to be surrounded by art, which kind of brings us to why we're here. But it was really, really great to go to that museum. They have a whole kids section, too, where we walk through, and it was all about the weather. But it was a really great experience to go. And, you know, we saw some great paintings and lots of really good art there. It's good.
Yes, we did.
And that's really it. That's all I've done except to go see you speak. And I'm going to London in March.
Nice.
To visit my daughter. So that's an exciting thing I've been planning. But other than that, I've been ready for tonight.
Yes,
and
same here.
We're ready to talk about
same
art.
Same here.
Yeah. So.
So it's time to introduce. By the way, the reason why we're doing this is we've been together 4 years, and we share, and so does NJ Discover, because we're part of NJ Discover, we share this commitment and this caring for artists, for musicians. It's just part of who we are and what we are. And that's why how this all came together tonight. Mm-hmm. So the first artist I want to introduce, it gives me great pleasure to introduce Cortez Robinson. And we have a history.
Yes.
And that's why you're here, because when we decided to do a show about artists, you came up first, because we have like a 4-year history. I've been following your art, as you know, for 4 years. When you're in Asbury Park, I was there. When you had this wonderful show on esoteric urbanism in New Brunswick, I was there. I was there in Freehold 4 or 5 weeks ago, and you were giving an address. So I love your art. So
thank you.
First up, Cortez, tell us how people can find you, your websites.
Esotericurbanism.com.
Okay.
And just Google esoteric urbanism, it pops up.
Okay. And how about just a little bit of a bio of yourself?
I started art at a very young age. My parents introduced art to me. And I was always into art that was different, street art, graffiti art. And it kind of ties into the music. So growing up in the 80s, listening to hip hop and seeing graffiti, all of that kind of infused into what I do today. So early influences are Keith Haring, Basquiat, Andy Warhol, and then stuff that kids in the neighborhood were doing. I was blessed to have young artists, graffiti artists, kind of show me the ropes, and it was really cool to experience that during the 80s and be in the midst of a movement that's still going strong today.
Okay. Did you, this is off the top, did you do graffiti? Did you
hit the walls? I wasn't that good with graffiti. The funny thing is, I was very much influenced by it, but because of living in Scotch Plains, New Jersey, having it as an outlet, we got in trouble for doing it. My parents were on me, and so I never really had the chance to do it. But when I went to college, I went to school at the Newark School of Fine and Industrial Arts. So I was in Newark, New Jersey. I met a lot of graffiti artists. And again, being so close to New York, I was able to just jump on the PATH train, go into the city, and really get into a lot of art that was out on the street, in the museums, in the galleries. And so there was this kind of like a fine line between what was in the street and what was in the galleries. Wow. And so that was a big influence for me.
Plus, I remember you were saying earlier that you were brought to studios to art, to see art at a very young age.
Well, my mom was an amateur collector. And one of my first experiences in going to galleries or showrooms, my mom used to go into the city to put money on art. And I really had no clue what she was doing. She was just bringing me along. And so as a young kid, I would be in these showrooms. And one in particular, it was somewhere downtown. And inside this place was like a warehouse. And it was nothing but African art. So a lot of masks, a lot of statues. And so actually, my first love was sculpture. But seeing all of this, it kind of brings me, you fast forward ahead, and you look at the faces and the portraits. Is a big influence, and my mom definitely was kind of subliminally giving me art lessons by just sharing the art.
Oh yeah, I can see that. By the way, I love your art. I love your drawings.
Thank you.
Really, really amazing. You had also mentioned that you have something coming up in March and April.
In March, Jersey City has this thing called JC Fridays. So four times out of the year, they have the first Friday, and they do this big event throughout the whole city. And there's art shows, there's concerts, there's poetry readings. And so Gia Gelato and Cafe is having an opening for me. So I'm displaying my art there, and that's March 4th.
And how can we should go to that?
And then I'm also having something in April. It's at the Living Incubator Performance Space, and that's in the Gateway Center in Newark, New Jersey. And what's happening there, and this is like my love, activism and art coming together. So the name of the show is Misogyny is the Root of All Evil. And so originally it was supposed to be a one-man show addressing misogyny. Then I thought, why address, it sounds kind of funny to address misogyny and not have women included in it. And I know so many women artists, so I started reaching out to women artists, poets, dancers, and it's all coming together. And the whole idea is stemmed from a friend of mine and I having conversations. Her name's Kim Jacob. And we would have these conversations and she would call me out on my own misogyny. And in the process, she would always say, hashtag misogyny is the root of all evil. And so it became a concept for a show. And so that's what this is happening on April 2nd, which is my birthday. So it's going to be really cool.
Yeah, it sounds great.
You can do the alternative spaces, which she does.
Oh, well, yeah. So we can find your art in restaurants, right? In alternative spaces.
Yes,
is that how we call it?
Yes.
Alternative spaces.
Well, I call it alternative spaces. But with the economy, the way it is, a lot of galleries are kind of shifting. You sometimes go into spaces and it isn't just art. It's sometimes art. It's sometimes T-shirts. It's sometimes music. And so I've been finding opportunities and showing my art in restaurants. So the first restaurant was Vonda's Kitchen, which is in Newark, New Jersey. And Vonda McPherson gave me the opportunity and the platform to show my artwork there. Then she opened up another spot called Duke Southern Table, which is in downtown Newark, New Jersey. And so I curated the spot there. Then going down South Jersey, Asbury Park, I'm in and out of Asbury Park a lot. There was a restaurant, there is a restaurant down there called At the Table, which is at 311 Bond Street. So I have artwork there. Then right around the corner from my house, a soul food spot opened up, and the owners happened to have people that work there that live in my building. And somehow we just connected, and so my artwork is there as well.
That's
so it's
fantastic.
Really convenient to have these spaces, as well as places like in Freehold, the Freehold Art Gallery,
right.
which is right next to CVS in downtown Freehold, and things just came together.
Lots of stuff.
This is kind of an obvious question, but not necessarily. But if you can talk about social conscience in art, and also an obvious the African American experience, on how that comes into your art. You said you wear it on your sleeve.
Yeah, in a sense, I wear it on my sleeve only because I am an African American artist. I mean, if it was up to me, I wouldn't want to be known as a African-American artist, just an artist. We get locked into titles, but at the same time, being an African-American artist gives me a vantage point to create art that comes from my experience. So it's been a pleasure and sometimes a pain in the neck.
Okay.
But I like to do conscious artwork. And for example, the art gallery, Freehold Art Gallery, which is in downtown Freehold. It's an example of middle America. It's predominantly white. And here I am, an African-American artist who lives in the neighborhood, and I'm able to have the creative freedom to show my work with no boundaries. And that's an amazing thing. So at the same time, when you go to someplace like Newark, it isn't as a novelty, so to speak. So I love being able to go into places where I'm not the norm, and I'm just being me, and so it's a great thing. And also it gives me an opportunity to speak on certain issues, like, say, police brutality, misogyny, just whatever comes to mind, and it's great.
We should go to look at your work now. So
okay.
We can, Kurt can cue the first piece of art, and let's have Cortez kind of talk about some
and
of your
art. And I
don't
know if it's the portrait or the one kind of,
it's
the portrait.
The portrait.
Okay, throughout my career, Basquiat, even Picasso. And one of my favorite artists is Andy Warhol. So one of my New Year's resolutions was to introduce photography, which I love, into my artwork. I've been doing photography for the past maybe 2 years, but not really introducing it into my artwork. And me being an amateur photographer, I felt funny hiring or asking people to be models for my artwork. So the first couple of pictures I've done have been me. And utilizing Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, it's real easy to now take pictures. And I might be in my house and I'm clicking away, and then I could go to the computer, manipulate things, and post it, just throw it out there. So this portrait that you see is a portrait of me, one of the first in a series of self-portraits that I did. And it's funny because a lot of people thought I was being might think I'm vain and taking this whole bunch of pictures of myself, but it was really, I didn't want to bring anybody else into the creative process, so I'm utilizing myself.
Okay.
Interesting.
And do you have another one to cue up there?
Yes.
All right, cue the other.
And the next one, I believe, So this one originally was a sketch of myself and a girlfriend. And I kind of altered it a little so it wouldn't look like me or my girlfriend, just because. And so something new for me is utilizing drips. A lot of my paintings are very neat and flat, somewhat, I feel somewhat rigid. This is something new for me to just kind of hit the canvas and get a little dirty and have fun with it.
Okay, great.
It's one of my favorite ones.
Oh, thank you.
We both like that a lot. Okay. We're going to move on.
Okay. Are we going to ask him his last question? Which is the best and worst, right?
Yes, real
quick. We
want
to ask this to
yes.
you. What, yes. what is the best and what is the worst thing about being an artist?
The best thing about being an artist is being able to navigate through social situations where I might be rubbing elbows with millionaires, and then at the same time, I could go down the street and go to a function where just regular folks, and being able to go back and forth, that's a really great thing. The bad part about being an artist is, unlike, say, an accountant or a doctor, the price is $400 and people want to negotiate. So it's almost like you're devaluing the artwork. And as an artist, they don't ask you, well, have you painted something lately? They'll ask, so did you sell anything today? And it's a pain in the neck to be kind and come up with an answer that's not going to make them feel offended.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
That's
good
interesting.
Answer.
So I'm looking at Maria. Maria Savarese.
Hello.
So after Cortez, you are I've known you the second longest as an artist.
Yep.
And met you several years ago because you found me on Facebook.
I did. I found you. I was impressed by your writing.
Thank
you.
And then I learned of your story and your art and your creativity and your inspiration. And so Tara and I, we met, we chatted at the Seville. And and then sometime after that, I came to your studio and I interviewed you and we chatted and we became great friends. And that's where we're at. So, here you are.
Here I am.
So how about just give some websites and contact information?
Okay, my website is miaartonline, all one word, .com. I'm also on Etsy at miaartonline on Etsy.com, however you look that up. And on Facebook, you can look me up at miaart.
Okay.
And it will be a self-portrait of mine that I've done.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you can...
Well,
take it from here.
Maria is, she's just, I met her once at the diner a while back, and she's such a beautiful, warm, kind person. You have so much great energy,
Thank you.
It's so nice to know you, and you've been Cal's friend for a while. You have art, and you have jewelry, and what's, I think, really special about you and what we really liked about your art is that you've been through a really difficult time in your life, and you came through. You're a survivor.
I am. I'm a breast cancer survivor.
Yes.
It's been 4 years now.
Yeah.
Yep.
Now, how has the changes in your life affected your art?
I think that losing my mother to the same disease actually affected me more, because in order to see her, I started to create her in my artwork. Before that, I was I was a crafter. You know, I would make things with clay. I'm trained as potter. I'm a professional potter. But I think getting diagnosed, it took away all fear. How can you fear anything anymore if you've actually gone through something that you weren't sure if you were going to get through or not? And so I had to start over, because before I got sick, I was in galleries. I had been in restaurants. I was in New Hope, in different furniture stores. The same thing like Cortez said, sometimes it's hard to get into a gallery, or you don't like to get in the gallery setting is a little bit more rigid, but it's very open to be in a place like a restaurant or a furniture shop where your piece can be one of the only things that's actually on the wall, which is interesting. But then after getting sick, I had to really start all over. Wow. And I'm on my way back now. And now, all of a sudden, instead of doing painting, I'm doing jewelry.
Yeah.
That's where I started
off
with
again. So you didn't do the jewelry?
I never really. I mean, I would make myself, you know, earrings, mm-hmm. but never spending hours on one piece
of
jewelry.
Beautiful jewelry.
And I can sit there and I turn on a movie that I've seen a million times and I just do, and I get it.
Yeah.
I get it done. And then at the end, somebody wants it immediately, which is really rewarding.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Everyone has to look at her art. Her jewelry is beautiful.
There will be some pictures.
We talked a couple times about this dream project of yours,
yes.
and something about energy energy on a wall. So can you kind of? I thought that was really fascinating. If you could elaborate.
Well, something I began doing for myself after losing my mother was I started taking her items, her tin that she used to put cookies in, and I distressed it, actually. I took her curtain rods. I hammered the heck out of them. And I took those pieces. I rusted them up because I think that's maybe how I was feeling inside after losing her. And I took all those items and I created a piece of art. And it's in my kitchen. Then I kept going with it. And then I realized that other people are touched by this as well. And that they want a piece of somebody that they lost or somebody that they love that's still with them. So I started and I came up with the name called Grandma's Purse. And I thought about when my own grandmother passed away and I had Grandma's Purse. And Grandma's Purse had strange little things in it. You know, she collected twist ties. I don't know why. You know, there was only 14 cents. There was her license. What do you do with it? And to take those items, to alter them, I'm very big into altered items, alter them, collage them three-dimensionally, and create something that somebody has not only old stories, but a new story to keep that person going.
Now, you're doing that now, or is this something you wanted to do?
I do that now. I have actually done a piece for one woman who lives in... South River. Mostly I've done them for myself and then done samples to show people actually what it can actually look like. But I have done it where a piece of grandma's jewelry or mom's jewelry has broken and I'll create a whole new piece of art or a whole new piece of jewelry out mm-hmm. of that piece. And that I've done actually many times. People bring me their old broken things a lot and say, can you make me something new with grandma's old necklace?
Wow. That's wonderful.
It is. It really is nice to put new life into something.
So different.
That's great.
It really is so neat. Why don't we jump?
Jump.
We're going to jump.
Yeah.
We'll jump. Let's cue up some of your art.
Okay. The first one is one of... We're ready?
I'm not sure.
Are you good at reading lips?
No, never been very good at reading.
Okay,
lips. They need to hold up a sign because I can see it.
They should hold up a sign so we know what...
Well, while they're getting ready...
All right, Maria,
on going?
No, I want to ask you about your quote. You had mentioned when we were interviewing you earlier.
Okay, that is a big one, something I think about a lot. When Michelangelo was asked after creating the Sistine Chapel, the Statue of David, which is a funny story because actually the Statue of David... There was a mold made of him, and there was 50 copies of the statue, just his bust. And we actually had one in my house growing up. Mm-hmm. It since broke. Don't tell anybody. Oh, my gosh, it broke. But we actually had one of those. So Michelangelo's always been an amazing inspiration. When he was asked at 87 years old, have you done everything that you wanted with your life? And he said, "Ancora imparo," which means I am still learning. And I think about it all the time. I am still learning. Mm-hmm. No matter what you're faced with, there's so many lessons to learn.
Yeah, I like that. I always say that.
I
say I'm a work in progress.
Yes.
Same kind of thing.
Yep. The wise man knows that he knows nothing. I like that.
There you go.
Wow, I love
that.
That's
a good way to be.
And being the oldest one in this room,
yes.
I certainly can appreciate those things because I am continuing to learn, truly. So are we ready? I can't.
We see a pink piece of paper.
What's it say? Cut. Commercial break.
Oh, all right. Okay. We're gonna go to
okay.
a commercial.
Commercial break.
All right. So
thank
that's
you.
What
we
all of that machinations and gyrations back there was for a commercial.
Do I go first?
Yes, you do.
Okay. So the windmill.
We're going to honor our sponsors now.
Okay. And one of our sponsors is the Windmill Restaurants, and there are locations in West Long Branch, North Long Branch, Belmar, Brick, Ocean Grove, Red Bank, and Freehold, and they are celebrating their 50th anniversary. Yay! for good reason, their iconic food. They have burgers, they have hot dogs, and cheese fries. And I can't imagine anyone from New Jersey that doesn't know about the windmill.
Correct.
And
correct.
I'm sure we all have our favorite. I think mine's the hot dog. They have got amazing toppings. And what about you?
Well, you know, I don't.
You don't eat that?
Oh. I don't eat meat.
Well, then you have to have the cheese fries.
I have the cheese fries.
Okay. Yes.
So and it's they have chicken. They have chicken.
Oh, there you go.
I have chicken there.
So in a casual, fast setting, they are truly your happiness spot.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, www.windmillhotdogs.com.
Yes.
Yes.
That's where you can go to.
That's right.
Check them out.
So I'm going to talk about Neo Zoe, which means new life, and how I, and you all heard about how I met Marianne Castella from Neo Zoe through the magic of television and YouTube. So, and it works, and she's amazing. And the funny thing about Neo Zoe, she can do a lot of these things. If you're in Colorado and you want to catch up to her here in New Jersey, she can do stuff with Skype and feel, you know, the energy and do stuff, and it's quite remarkable.
Wow.
She was doing some stuff with me and my knee the other day from, you know, 30 miles up on the parkway. But anyway, Neo Zoe is new life through balance healing. It's a very unique holistic wellness company that brings together various teachings and techniques in recognizing the interconnection of body, mind, spirit, and the importance of creating complete healing on a whole, nurturing and comforting environment. And I lived it and I saw it. Anyway, Marianne Castello, the founder, is a board-certified holistic health practitioner and a licensed massage therapist. You can, they are located in Cranford, New Jersey, www.neosoe.com.
Wonderful. And then we do have one more sponsor.
Yes, yes, yes.
Which is the Food Bank of Monmouth and Ocean County. Just a little bit about the food bank. In 1980, there were 40 food pantries in the United States. Today, there are 40,000. What does that mean? Did you know that 1 out of 10 people living in Monmouth and Ocean Counties receive food from the food bank? In addition to food, they provide services that help to solve hunger. It takes community support to build food secure communities. Together, we can make a difference in the lives of 131,000 men, women, and children who struggle with hunger. If we can donate, if we can bring food, if we can volunteer at any of the food banks, that's what you need to do. Everybody needs to help out any way you can. They have a website, www.foodbankmoc.org. Thank you so much for being our sponsor, and thank yes. you to Windmill, and thank you to, how do you say that?
Neo Zoe.
Neo Zoe. Love
okay.
that.
New life.
Very cool.
New life.
Now, were we able to get the pictures up for Maria? Yes, we do have
okay,
thumbs up.
So okay, so you're going to talk about your art.
Okay, so the first piece that's going to pop up is one of my face pieces, which is a spirit piece. It's I actually took my mother's cutting board. She used to cut our bread on. I cut that up into 5 pieces. I made some paper. So her eyes, with the circles around her eyes, are paper that I made out of envelope covers. You can use, I make paper out of everything, actually. You know, I've used it from the tree where I grew up. So there's all different kinds of paper on that one. I believe there may be a piece of one of the walls. I'm sorry, Daddy, but I did make, like, take a piece of, like, the board that made up the wall. Anyway, each one of them represents my mother. Every single face piece that I've made, and I have a whole collection. Most of them are sold. They all represent my mother. I did make a brand new one, which I don't know if you'll be able to see, but I finished her yesterday. Her name's Margaret.
Wow.
And she looks just like my mother. I don't know how, but she does. And so this is something that I do for myself, and I would love to do for other people.
Wow.
Where her eyes are mirrors, her mouth is a mirror, and these always represent her heart, and that's a mirror. And just little bits and pieces. This is also parts of my house on Cottrell. I'm sorry,
Daddy. It's amazing. I love it.
And then the second piece that pops up is a green piece. There's women dancing. The two women that are dancing represent me and my sister. There's a spiral, which represents my mother's love. And we're dancing. We're dancing in her love.
Wow.
And I have a whole series that I've done of like a heart and soul series, where you can't really see the people, their ideas. So that's where I've been going with a lot of my artwork lately. Then the other pieces that are going to pop up are going to be my jewelry. And these are a labor of love. This is not freedom. This is not spontaneity. When it comes to doing the jewelry pieces, that's something that had to be learned, had to be perfected. Same with my pottery. It's something that had to be practiced. You have to do it right in order to execute a good final product. So that's what these are. I can't seem to keep them. The ones that I'm wearing today are ones that I have said, these are mine. And so I haven't sold them. But people seem to like them. They're in a lot of people's private collections, people who actually collect jewelry. So I'm honored. To all of you who have purchased any of that jewelry, I'm honored that you wear it. Thank you very much.
It's wonderful. That's cool.
Your question, best or worst?
Oh,
yes.
This. What is the best thing about being an artist, and what is the worst thing about being an artist?
The best thing is I can wake up every day and be a totally different person. I can be a jeweler. I can be a potter. I can be a teacher. I teach. I run the pottery department and the jewelry departments at Country Roads Day Camp, which that's completely different from being in your home and making things yourself. I can be tidying my room and find something, and all of a sudden I'm splashing paint all over the place. And that's an amazing thing that not many professions have, that changeability. Mm-hmm. The worst part, you don't know what's going to come next. You don't know what's going to come next. You might be busy, busy, busy for 2 weeks, and then all of a sudden there's nothing. So, you know, the lack of prosperity that can come along at times with being an artist can be a challenge. But I don't really care about prosperity. I care about living life the way I'm supposed to live my life.
It's beautiful.
I identify with that. Mm-hmm. I'm an artist. Now I'm a novelist of sorts, and I look at all of you and we live it. Tara.
Yes.
How did Sheila Kubarski get here?
Okay, well, we were looking for artists, and we went to the Monmouth Museum in Lincroft, and we walked around looking at everything, all the painting and the artwork, and there's some videos, and there's, I think there might have been a sculpture or something, but we were walking around, and I said, Calvin.
We were researching.
We were researching,
yes.
And we were trying to get the feel for the art, like what's going on, how do we feel about art? We wanted to know how we felt about art, so... I said, well, I feel like...
There were 100 pieces of art.
Right, and I said, well, I feel like I like lots of colors, and I like the vibrancy, and you mentioned that you liked a lot of paintings where it was a scene with maybe people quietly sitting.
Yeah, people are like a farmhouse on a mountain.
Yeah, stuff
like
that.
A couple birds flying overhead there. Yeah. Kind of simple, but...
So we were kind of going back and forth about what we liked, and I said, Calvin, look at that painting right there. Let's sit down. Sit down. It's hard to get Calvin to sit down anyway. And I got him to sit. I said, let's just sit in front of this painting because it's so vibrant and there's so much energy from there. Do you feel it? Makes you feel good. Do you feel it? And I'm sitting there talking, and he's like, wait a second. I know that artist. I recognize that name.
I didn't know. Deep in my memory banks, I knew I had 4,200 Facebook friends, and I've seen that name on Facebook. So we decided, because she had picked you, and I kind of knew you from Facebook. So when I went home that night to decide to send you a little note that we'd like to have you on as a guest, I saw you from North Plainfield, and then a bolt of lightning hit me.
And talk about synchronicity. I'm always talking about synchronicity in the universe. I discover through the process of discovery, because we are NJ Discover. So through the process of discovery, I find out that you and my dear, dear, dear cousin Stuart, who we all know and
yes.
love.
Hello, cousin
And you grew up together in North Plainfield, and here you are. Yes.
Yes, here I am. Here.
So if you could just tell everybody, you have so much by way of bibliography, so how can people find out stuff about you?
Well, I have a website. It's GrabarskySkystudio.com, G-R-A-B-A-R-S-K-Y, studio.com. I also have a Facebook page that's Sheila Grabarski, and a business Facebook page, and I'm on Instagram, and a few other places. I'm in a lot of different venues, and an online gallery called ugallery.com, the letter U. And that's, you can see all of my work on. I keep it current. I maintain that website.
Okay.
Okay, I'm gonna bring up the painting that I saw, and you said that's the Garden Series, right? Is that
That's
okay.
Not the, that was Orange Segment.
Oh, okay.
That you saw. That was more current. The Garden Series goes back further. It's years ago. I was painting gardens.
Okay, tell us about that, because that's what I want to know about the Garden Series.
It's very interesting because I'm not a gardener. And I love being in gardens. Who doesn't love being in beautiful gardens with all the colors? But I never gardened. And all of a sudden, as I'm working and I'm studying my work to see what goes next, there's a flower and there's something floral. And boy, I'm really enchanted with all the greens lately. Well, 19 paintings later, I had the Fantasy Garden Series. And it was just like they were just pouring out of me. I just enjoyed doing it for the time that I had. It was not exactly like Picasso's Blue Period, but it was my garden period. Mm-hmm. And lately I've been thinking about maybe starting it again, maybe because spring is coming.
Maybe.
I don't know.
They're absolutely beautiful, and they can be on the website. On your website, there's...
Yes, one of the paintings I'm going to queue up is from the Garden Series
Good.
There's a... we're talking about the Garden Series, and then there's a dichotomy here. And the dichotomy is we did some... Because we're very good investigative reporters, you and I. So in discovering your amazing website and your histories... We discovered your retrospective page, and we took a your past and German expressionist and frightening, and we found a whole nother side to Sheila that we're beginning to know. So you want to talk about that?
Well, it's called evolution and living and growth. And as an artist, one of the most important things for any artist is to become better at what they do and grow and learn how... actually to allow life to come through and evolve. And I went through some really rough times, as we all do, and my childhood, I was discouraged from being an artist. Nobody wanted me to pursue it, and so I had to really be driven. It actually made me more driven to pursue my passion. But I didn't even know it was a passion because I couldn't address it. But the work that you're referring to was working that through. Working through the tough times and ripping up some people in my life that I needed to rip up. And then I was better. And then things got lighter and happier, and I evolved into more happy work.
Did the Garden Series come after the retrospective?
Oh, by far. Oh, yeah. Yeah, those older works, I think they pretty much ended around the 90s, the early 90s. Mm-hmm. But I had to do it. You know, it was necessary. My work, it was different then, but if you really study it, which I don't think people have to do, the colors were similar. It was as intense.
Mm-hmm.
My work now is much more layered, and my process involves much more time-intensive work where I layer and layer, and it's never exact. You know, it's hard to know. Some of the best artists in the world don't know when to stop. You know, it's hard to know when to say it's done, birthed. It's like really process of labor.
Okay. Should we queue up? Can we queue up? Okay, we're queuing your.
Okay.
If thumb went up there, that wonderful thumb. So
I have three because I'm not going to take long.
Let's do that.
Any of them. The first one is Fantasy Garden, and it's number 15 of the 20 that I painted. And I think in this one you can see all of the intense greens and the layering that it takes me a very, very long time to do. Sometimes I just have to put on a layer, and because I want a certain kind of luminosity, I have to put it aside and work on a different one. But that's a good example of the Fantasy Garden. Some of these are in public collections, actually. And I'm trying to think, this might have been one that was in a calendar for the Trenton Museum, Ellerslie Mansion. I can't remember where else it was, but I'll come back to it if I think of it.
Next.
The next one is Some Birds Don't Fly. And this is a much more current piece. It's mixed media. I incorporated yarn into it because yarn was lying around my studio, so I adhered it with some medium and used it as part of my layering technique. The title comes from the fact that I didn't fly. I wouldn't get on a plane. Just recently I did. And so now that's an old title. But Some Birds Don't Fly, I think a lot of people that don't fly nowadays might relate to that. You?
Yeah.
You don't fly?
Oh, we'll talk about it later. No, I don't.
It was an experience.
No, I don't.
I think the airport was worse than the flight itself. The third piece is very indicative of my newer, happier work. It's called The Clouds Can't Win, which is much more about not letting depressing thoughts into your sunshine. It's a painting that, it's right over here, actually. It's a painting that has a lot of grays representing clouds. I actually don't think of the titles till after the work is completed. And I'm trying lately to focus my titles on more upbeat kinds of titling. So those are my three.
Okay. This meant something to you when we were chatting beforehand in the green room. Where we were before was the green room, even though it's not green.
We knew that.
We knew that, of course. Talk about how to look at abstract.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Well, as you said, Cal, you really like scenes that are representational and or decorative, that you can see what they are and be comfortable with them. Very normal part of the human condition to look at something and want to be comfortable with it and have it represent something to you, and you know what it is, as opposed to Tara Jean, who got this energy from it. You can look at an abstract work, and instead of thinking of it as a picture, you can think of it as an experience and relate to not just the composition and the line and the colors, but to how it makes you feel and what you really get from it, as opposed to actually not seeing what's in it, not seeing anything that's comfortable to you. But it's like music in that it touches a part of you that nobody can describe what that place is.
Yeah.
One of my biggest influences is Kandinsky. I know you were just going to ask me that.
Yeah, I was.
Kandinsky was very close friends with a composer named Schoenberg, and he so believed Kandinsky that music and art touched a place inside of you that was so similar. I've also read that, you know, music comes to you in vibrations in the air, so does color. Color is broken up light. And so they're very, very similar. And just to say that Kandinsky did some of his titles based on musical themes. He had a series called Improvisations, and he had a series called Compositions.
Wow.
So I find music and art to always go hand in hand. If I'm having trouble working, I just put on Janis Joplin.
Oh, wow.
And
wow.
And then I paint well.
I quote Janis about once a week. Freedom is something.
Freedom is just another,
thing that you can't lose.
Nothing left to lose.
Nothing left to lose. It's just because I came out of that time period. Best and worst.
But well, before we do the best and worst, we have a minute. I just wanted to talk about the one when we were in the museum and I saw that painting and the energy and that really happy feeling I got from looking at it. And then you said, I have retrospective, and I pulled it up on the computer and I looked at it, and there's the one Trapped, and it was really hard to look at it. It actually hurt me to look at it, and I
really
got scared. It was so hard to look
at
that.
It's all energy. It's just a different kind of
energy. But you do
energy.
It well. That's the thing. Okay, so the final question. The best thing about being an artist and the worst thing about being an artist.
Mine is brief. The best thing about being an artist for me is being highly sensitive to life, to everything around me, to color, to music, to everything. And the worst thing about being an artist is being highly sensitive and feeling the bad things really intently.
Okay. Wow. Okay.
A little bit of a group discussion now. We started to touch on this in the green room. The role, your feelings, quickly, the role of an artist in society. Cortez, start off.
Ooh, it varies.
Okay.
I think we have the ability to tap into, I guess, people's souls. And it varies because art speaks, and I'm trying to come up with something very profound, but we beautify the world. And we're able to take our own energy and put it on canvas, put it on in jewelry, put it in film, in other mediums, and that's kind of a blessing to take what you feel and share it with the world.
Yeah. I have to say, I'm in love with these two people. How to have three artists in a room. First off, I've never been in a room with other artists, and
really?
This is the best feeling I've ever had in my entire life, to be with two people that really absorb everything that's around them. And I think that that's our job to open up a dialogue as artists. We open up that dialogue between people. They see something that we've created, and it gives them, what does this mean to you? Like you asked Cal, what does this mean to you? That's a great responsibility, something that we need.
Yeah. I
just think that my role at this point in my career is to bring happiness to people who are so bogged down in the chaos of the world that we live in right now. And if I can provide any opportunity to transcend it, that's my role.
Very nice.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
Thank you for sending me this, because I was one thing I omitted, and I did want to omit this because I thought it was really, I thought it was really neat, and because I came out of Newark, and I went to high school with this writer named Philip Roth. He was a little bit older than me, and who's a, I mean, he's a Pulitzer Prize winning writer, and I would love to model myself after him if I ever can, if there's enough time left for me to do that. But what thrilled me when you and I were chatting is because you mentioned your connection to Philip Roth, because they're making a major, why don't you tell about that?
One of the paintings that was up on the monitor before, The Some Birds Don't Fly, is going to be one of seven paintings in a Hollywood movie being released this year, based on the novel by Philip Roth, American Pastoral. I'm not sure when the release is, but it's got some big stars.
Jennifer Connelly?
Jennifer Connelly.
See, I'm a groupie, I know this stuff. I love this stuff.
And Dakota Fanning?
Yeah. This is...
Yeah, Ian McGregor.
I have this great affinity to Philip Roth because we came out of the same school. I would love to... We took different paths. He went one way, I went the other, and here I am.
So now I'm on TV and in the movie.
Yes.
They're filming right now in Pittsburgh, and I happen to be in a gallery in Pittsburgh, and that's how that all.
So, are you allowed to be on the set while your painting is there? It's like your child. You should be able to be there.
No, I'm really not.
Because I would be your best friend, you know.
And we
you're
we'll be
really
able to
best
spot
friend.
It.
No, but you can be my date for the Oscars.
That's a deal. It's okay over there. I have this Oscar quest. I would love. Someday, just
crash it.
Just to hang out.
Just crash it.
I'm too big to crash.
With the hat.
So,
wear the wig and go as Howard Stern, remember?
I know.
Tell your wife to put a red carpet down.
Well, I want the real thing. You know what? At this stage of life, I want the real thing. I'm working on that. Now, we have one. I alluded to this. We have one final question, which is a one word. Question.
Cool.
Don't be nervous.
I'm gonna have fun with
three
this.
Minutes. We got three minutes.
It's time. By the way, we have done phenomenal tonight.
We are
a machine.
We are amazing.
This is all done here. Every second is accounted for. We've done wonderful. So,
I have one
final question to ask you guys, and here it is. Before I leave this earth, I won't be satisfied until I.
Can't be one word, but
it can't
one statement.
Word.
Well, then, it can't be. You take it, Cortez. I hope you all like this. You're not going to hate me in the morning.
Oh, boy. Baba Booey.
Oh, my gosh.
Can I take it?
You
yes.
take it. You take it.
I won't be satisfied.
You'll never be satisfied?
I will never be satisfied. I will never make the perfect painting. Never. And that's what makes an artist.
She's good. She
constantly
has it.
Driven.
Wow. There you go. That's what you get for artists. That's your answer.
That's a pretty
Anybody
good
else want to?
Can I give you the real? No, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
Did that fly over everybody's head?
No.
Kind of.
I really don't have an answer for that. In one word?
Well, make it a sense. We're not.
And
1 minute.
What's the question again?
It's okay.
Wrap it up.
Can you repeat the question?
Before I leave this earth, I won't be satisfied until I...
See, my daughter's grown and beautiful.
Oh. Oh,
that's great. That's great.
That was good.
That's great.
Until I know.
Okay, until I know. Period. Done.
Until
okay.
Know.
All right, closing.
Good. Wow. Put them on the spot. They came through.
Yeah.
Okay.
Closing.
Thank you.
What? NJDiscover.com.
Go to NJDiscover.com. On the article that Calvin wrote about the show tonight, you will see artwork. You'll see the artists, and you can find out what their websites are, how to contact them, where you can see their art. All that information is on NJDiscover.com. Okay.
Okay. Thanks to our sponsors.
Yes, thank you.
The Windmill.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you so much, Kevin.
He's wonderful.
In words of Arnold Schwarzenegger in The Terminator, we'll be back.
We'll be back.
One other thank you to Kevin Seary and Long Branch Cablevision, Local Access Channel 20.
Thank you.
Who airs our show every night at 9 p.m.
Mm-hmm.